Hey there, Safecrackers! Get your combinations ready because it is time for the Comic Vault! Let's review comics! Today, on the Comic Vault, we have Superman Shazam First Thunder. I get a little giddy when I see Shazam miniseries. I always want them to be good. I really do. And a lot of the time when I pick them up, it turns out to be an origin story. Now, I had to know that this was going to be an origin story because it says First Thunder. It's not 200th Thunder, it's First Thunder. So, it makes sense that this would be an origin story again. I get a little sick of seeing a bazillion origin stories for Shazam and for Captain Marvel, that is. For the Shazam continuity, but I get so tired of it. I want to see more regular Captain Marvel stuff. More regular. I guess it doesn't really matter what I call him now. I mean, DC. Ask DC what to call him. They'll give you a million answers. So, I think this is worthwhile. It's only 4 issues. It has a lot of that classic Shazam stuff that you expect. Captain Marvel has to deal with a lot of magical creatures of similar origin to him. Not necessarily from the Wizard Shazam, but relating to the types of magic that the Wizard Shazam either fights against or has a herald or hero, whatever he wishes to call him, to fight against those people. Anyway, I find this to be really interesting. Shazam and Superman are characters who just naturally fit together within the DC universe. They're sort of two sides of the same coin in the way of how their powers work. Superman is supposed to be biological in origin. We'll call it science fiction knee. Superman has a science fiction mythos attached to his history, but his powers aren't exactly science fiction because there's no real science to it. It's just fiction. But Shazam, on the other hand, Captain Marvel, on the other hand, is magic. So you have science, magic. Two sides of the same coin. But I was looking to see if my two-faced coin was in reach, but it's not. I can't do the physical analogy. So, Superman Shazam First Thunder. An origin story. I'm sick of origin stories, but it worked well. I thought Judd Winnick... by the way, this is by Judd Winnick and Joshua Middleton, and it came out in 2005. And I thought he managed to weave a story here that was really very interesting. People in this book keep you interested. And I like to see... I like that the villains are fun. I like that the villains are funny, but they're not funny in the way of a pie in the face. They're not funny in the way of constantly shouting one-liners that can get irritating. So, the villains are fun and funny. For example, Dr. Savannah, one of the main nemeses to Captain Marvel, says, at some point in this series, not where I'm trying to find, which I just found it, but at some point in this series, what's his name? Dr. Savannah says, get Lex Luthor on the line. He talks to his personal assistant and says, get Lex Luthor on the line, and he says, why? Well, because he has a caped idiot to deal with, too. Superman. Huzzah. So, I think that's interesting. I hadn't really connected the dots. I knew that there were similar powers between Captain Marvel and Superman. Similar, not the same. Not by any means. Of course, they're both super strong, they're both super fast, and they both can fly. And then they have a bunch of really interesting creative things. Superman has super intelligence to a certain extent, and Captain Marvel has the wisdom of Solomon or something. But... it had never occurred to me that they both have a bald villain. Now, a bald villain who has lots of money and can do varying nefarious things. I find that interesting. I don't know why I've never thought about the relation between Dr. Savannah and Lex Luthor. I feel like Lex Luthor has gone through a progression of being mad scientist, businessman. Like, he just, at some point, he went whoop and turned into the other thing. Dr. Savannah is kind of like taking all of Lex Luthor's history and shoving it into one guy. So he is the mad scientist, and he's also a businessman, at least in this. And I'm really pleased by how Dr. Savannah's characterization turned out. I will read to you a short excerpt from this between Dr. Savannah and his personal assistant. He says, get me Luthor on the phone. Luthor, you hate Lex Luthor. I never said that. You always say that. You said it an hour ago. Last week, there was a quote from you in News Time magazine where you wished throat cancer on him. Okay, I have issues. That's the kind of fun, funny stuff that you get from Dr. Savannah and from Lex Luthor in his limited appearance within this book. He does show up, and they do have a little bit of banter back and forth. I like the idea that we can have a little bit of fun with our villains without having to have them be over the top. I like that quite a lot. And I feel like if you're going to write a Captain Marvel Shazam book, you need to have a contrast. You don't want to have the quippy villains. You want to have somebody who is kind of serious. And if you're going to have somebody like Dr. Savannah, who's small and weird-looking and kind of strange, you want some of that fun stuff because you want people to be interested in the villain. You don't just want him to be nefarious. That's not interesting. I don't care about reading that stuff. If he were just nefarious, if he were just, I will get you, Captain Marvel. if that's all he was, I would just be speed reading to get past that, just so I could see Captain Marvel again, just so I could see Superman. Just so I could see the things that are not that guy. But in the past, when I've read things about Dr. Savannah, or dealing with Dr. Savannah, featuring Dr. Savannah, I get annoyed because that's exactly what it is. But in this, he's an interesting guy. he's fun. And he's crotchety. He's a cranky old man. But and there's even he even has an interesting line speaking with Lex Luthor, where he says something to the effect of, or Lex Luthor says, you're going to die before that happens, and Dr. Savannah says, please, I'll bury everyone here, which is an interesting goal, considering he's older than everyone that was on the roof that he was speaking to. So, he wasn't speaking to the roof, he was speaking to the people on the roof. Moving on. So, yes, he gets to fight varying magic creatures, he meaning Captain Marvel, and Superman gets to fight varying magic creatures. Now, these two guys come together. It makes sense that Dr. Savannah and Lex Luthor have a chat at some point. So it's natural, it's organic within the story that those two people meet up. Captain Marvel and Shazam, it's not exactly organic. These magic-using criminals happen to be in two cities. They're in one city, they're in Metropolis, and they get one artifact, and then they go to Fawcett City, where Captain Marvel is, and they try to get another artifact of some kind to do these things. And then they're hired by Lex Luthor, Dr. Savannah, blah, blah, blah. And those guys, they're more of just a device for the story. There's nothing that really ties them to much of an overall plot. Now, I don't know if this extends into anything else, but as far as I know, it's just a four-issue series. That kind of annoys me that we don't get more about who these guys are. The thing that brings the two heroes together is not something that becomes significant. It should be. It really should. otherwise, it's just a contrivance. What was the significance of being in Metropolis? What was the significance of being here and there? It doesn't matter because we never get to it. That's a problem. So it could have been integrated into the story better. This is a story that I found really interesting and lots of fun to read. The trouble is that I feel like, and I know Judd Winnick does good work. I would say that this is an example of good work, but there are problems with it that could have easily been fixed. So, Superman is slightly contrived to be in the area. and then it's just a series of battles. Now, the character arc comes from Captain Marvel being the young boy. Oh, man. I totally forgot his name. I know that like the back of my hand, and now that I'm shooting the video, I forget the name of the boy that turns in to Captain Marvel. Oh, my goodness. I was about to just pull it out and say it, and... Ugh. This is ridiculous. Anyway, so the boy that becomes Captain Marvel, we really see a story arc for him through this thing. You see Captain Marvel just kissing the ground that Superman walks on. Just, wow, you're Superman! Oh my goodness, I get to work with you! That's so cool! And Superman is taken aback a little bit. He thinks it's kind of strange, but he says, well, that's cool. Here's this super powerful guy, this guy who is pretty much every bit as powerful as I am, and in fact, in some ways, is more powerful than I am, because one of my weaknesses is magic. I don't have anything that I can really do against that. I have to figure out how to counteract magic, how to use my gifts to defeat magic, but I cannot battle it inherently. And he sees that and he says, well, Captain Marvel has lots of really interesting things. Maybe I should become friends with this guy. Maybe there's worthwhile. He obviously wants to be friends with me. So, yeah. So, Superman sort of puts away some of his leeriness and he has a little bit of apprehension. And then he says, how many extremely powerful people do you run into that want to talk to you? So, how many people... And this is considered... it even says in the very first page of the first issue that this is before The Flash and Wonder Woman. This takes place before Green Lantern. It takes place slightly after the appearance of... as it says, less than a year of the appearance of Batman in Gotham. And they refer to him as Stories of a Winged Creature. So a year after Stories of a Winged Creature arise in Gotham. And then Superman's been around for a while. So you get to see this boyish excitement that Captain Marvel. Woo! Don't say that around hardcore Captain Marvel fans. They'll freak out. So you get to see this progression where the boy is starting to become disenchanted or not disenchanted. There's a particular word for that storyline or for that particular type of story. Maybe they're disenchanted. I don't know. But disillusioned, that's the word. So he is looking at the real world because there are certain things that happen in the real world that are extremely dangerous. Here's a kid playing at being a hero because the wizard Shazam said, hey, here's these powers, go forth and be a hero. You have the right kind of morality for this. And the kid says, okay. And now he's realizing that there are things in life that are extremely dangerous, and that just because he is super powerful, just because he's nearly all powerful, doesn't necessarily mean that he can do as he wishes. People around him will get hurt. And Superman sees that as an issue. And Superman doesn't realize that... Billy Batson! Ha! Superman doesn't realize that Captain Marvel is actually this kid, Billy Batson, who turns into Captain Marvel. And there is a story arc for Superman, and I'll say that the thing that really sealed this first, or this is a origin story for me, is the last few pages. I'm not going to tell you what happened. It's not huge and climactic. In fact, I would have liked more dealing with, or more things tying all of the story and plot elements together. Fair enough. I would love to have that. But the last few pages made it interesting to me. How Superman deals with this information of Billy Batson being Captain Marvel. How Shazam, the wizard, believes, or how he can defend himself and say what reason there is to make a kid or make a kid into a superhero. And how Billy Batson reacts to tragedy as a kid being a hero. These are issues that I find really interesting, and I feel like there's a lot of room to play with Shazam. There's a lot of room to play with Captain Marvel being essentially a grown child. There's a lot of room to play with that. Jerry Ordway, I think it was Jerry Ordway. Oh my goodness. I forget. Anyway, Power of Shazam, which I've not read all of, but I've read spotty issues from. And there's lots of play, there's lots of playful stuff like that in there, and some of it's echoed in here. There's two writers that always get their names confused, and I'm almost certain that I got it wrong with Power of Shazam. So suffice it to say, whoever the writer for Power of Shazam is, I didn't look that up. I didn't intend to really make the comparison, but during the making of this video, I was suddenly swept away, and I had to mention Power of Shazam, and there are certain echoes of childhood trauma and childhood, or how a child as a grown man would act. I find it interesting. I think this is great stuff. I highly recommend reading this if you're interested in Captain Marvel and Superman together. It's interesting, it's pretty, it's decent artwork, and thanks for watching the Comic Vault, guys. I'm Vince, this is Geekvolution. We'll catch you next time.